Teaching Disciples Part 1. When he had called the people to himself with his disciples, also he said to them, Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. What will it be about rising from the dead? The disciples could understand it from Jairus' daughter who had died. But Yeshua was the Messiah. He had not come to die, but to reign. These words of Yeshua must have had a spiritual meaning. They taught something like being born again. The disciples had a clear concept of what the Christ should do. That made it difficult for Yeshua to explain to them that this was not so, that his mission was different, that he had not come to establish an earthly kingdom, that the way to glory was through the cross. Teachings in two phases, basic instruction, full knowledge. Teachings about the kingdom, the future and present kingdom, the largest in the kingdom, how to enter the kingdom. Teachings in two phases. Basic instruction. He looked up and said, I see people. They look like trees walking around. A healing recorded in Mark 8:22-26 is the strangest of those performed by Yeshua. In the first phase, man is able to see blurred. In the second phase, finally see clearly. This miracle serves as a parable of the way in which Yeshua was going to instruct his disciples, preparing them to grasp as best as possible the reality of his saving mission. In the first phase, the disciples had come to the conclusion that Yeshua was the Messiah, who secured that truth in their minds. Yeshua led them to declare it by asking them an indirect question and a direct question. But they were to remain silent regarding this statement, for they had not yet understood its full implications. Full knowledge. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. In the second phase of his teaching, Yeshua's words were very clear. Rejection, death, and resurrection, but something exploded in Peter's head. Lord, have mercy on me, on you. In no way shall this happen to you. Unknowingly, Peter was using the same tactic that Satan used in the wilderness. A easy path led Yeshua to an earthly kingdom. A difficult one led him to achieve salvation on our behalf. And that was not all. His followers had to be willing to tread the same path, take up the cross, and live or die for the precious gift of salvation, helping others achieve it. Teachings about the kingdom. The future and present kingdom. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Yeshua. Peter, James, and John were not fully aware that they were glimpsing on the mountain the kingdom of glory, a miniature representation of the second coming of Yeshua. What they were clear about was that they wanted to stay there, but that all that moment they did not perceive the true meaning of the words that Moses and Elijah spoke to Yeshua. So that the dead in Christ, represented by Moses, and the living faithful of the last generation, represented by Elijah, could enter glory, Yeshua had to die in Jerusalem. Upon descending from the mountain, the present state of the kingdom became evident. The lack of faith endangered its very structure. The apostles lacked faith, and the Spirit Father had lost confidence. With faith, everything is possible. But if you lack faith, cry out like that Father, I do believe, help me overcome my unbelief. The greatest in the kingdom. Sitting down, Yeshua called the 12 and said, Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last, the servant of all. Yeshua begins his way down to Jerusalem from Caesarea, stopping at Capernaum. He takes advantage of this period to instruct and prepare his disciples. But they, far from understanding what Yeshua wanted to teach them, disputed who would be the greatest when Yeshua proclaimed himself King in Jerusalem. First teaching. Taking a child, he states greatness in the kingdom. The first or the last, the greatest is the servant. The smallest and humbler must be treated as if he were Yeshua himself. Second teaching. Everyone has their part to do, and no one should be left behind in doing God's work, no matter how small. How to enter the kingdom. For everyone will be seasoned with fire, and every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. To tie a huge stone around your neck and throw yourself into the sea, cutting off a hand, a foot, or gouging out an eye, strange ways to save yourself, right? If we take these words literally, as many as do with the phrase, the worms that eat them do not die, and the fire is not quenched, we have to reach the following conclusions. 1. The redeemed will live eternally with a mutilated body. 2. The wicked will suffer eternally, but at least their body will be whole. The lesson from this exaggeration is obvious. Sin is so terrible that you must flee from it immediately. Abandoning sin is hard and costs sacrifice, but the result is worth and gives us peace. Every true self-sacrificing worker for God is willing to spend and be spent for the sake of others. Christ says, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. By earnest, thoughtful efforts to help where help is needed, a true Christian shows his love for God and for his fellow beings. He may lose his life in service, but when Christ comes to gather his jewels to himself, he will find it again.